Hi, it's movie recaps time. Today, we are going to talk about David Fincher's 1997 thriller film The Game. It's amazing, controversial, untraditional, and even a masterpiece. The film also stars Michael Douglas and Sean Penn. So, of course, spoilers ahead. Here's the mass recap. The Game is one of David Fincher's most amazing and most controversial thrillers. From a lonely protagonist to the juxtaposition of money with the hierarchical loneliness that comes from it, the continuous pressure that comes with money and power combined with the most amazing visuals and attention to detail that we see by David Fincher, amazing viewers at every turn, The Game is a masterpiece. But to be precise, a masterpiece with its controversies. As the plot of the film and the subject line are perhaps not the most traditional, at least among the films that were shown in the 90s, they sparked a lot of controversy at the time of its release. The film starts with the protagonist dreaming about his childhood, a childhood full of abundance, at least in monetary terms, with servants being all around the house, taking care of the young protagonist, and the little boy being treated like royalty because of the money and influence that his father has. The child has practically all the resources at his beck and call that a human being can imagine, from drivers and maids, to personal nannies and so on. And we then see our protagonist waking up from a dream of a dream childhood. A dream that he has experienced. A dream that is, or at least was, his reality. A lonely, yet an extremely appealing one. A loneliness that remains there despite the presence of so many kids being around the little boy. He feels alone and at the center of attention. As the protagonist wakes up from the dream, the first thing he hears is the rates of different shares on the news, indicating that his life starts from the business and that alone is the central thing around which his life revolves. Or to put it more precisely, that his life has been revolving around from childhood. As he wakes up and starts getting ready, he is the only person in his house except the servants, and then he drives to work. Again indicating that the only thing he keeps track of is his work. Moreover, as we see the protagonist driving his car to work, we see him driving in a set lane, and there are no other cars in his entire lane, indicating that not only his work is the sole thing towards which his life revolves, but also that his journey is extremely lonely. And the life he is living has been set and chosen for him even before he was a child, and now he has to walk, or more precisely drive, in the exact same lane every single day alone, as that is his destiny set by his father and his fortune. The only hint of the protagonist having some sense of human contact comes from his brother, who he goes to see in a restaurant. The scene is set up in a seemingly normal way, with the two having a good conversation in a restaurant, or is it? Here again David Fincher surprises us and gives us an insight into the actual relationship between the two and the nature of their conversation through amazing play with lighting and camera angles. When the light falls on the protagonist's brother, we see his face lighting up, and as the camera zooms into him, we see the black color that he is wearing perfectly blends with the background, indicating warmth and mystery at the same time. But when the camera revolves around the protagonist, we see his background as being the focus, and a wider shot indicating the sense of being guarded. And then the conversation ends with the staff of the restaurant wishing the protagonist happy birthday, and then his brother giving him the infamous CRS card which sets the game in motion in the next parts of the thriller. And then we see the protagonist driving back home after a long day at work. And this time too, we see that the road that he has been driving on has been already mapped out and chosen for him, with the lanes and trolley line track being replaced by electric wires that hang above the car. We see the car being driven in perfect symmetry to the electric lines, indicating that no part of his day or his life is up to him. Everything has been already chosen and all the protagonist is doing is simply following his destiny. This fact is more than ironic, as we see that the protagonist feels that he is free and in charge of his life and destiny, but he isn't represented by the juxtaposition that has been provided by his car. That is, an automated vehicle of remote but still following these extremely intricate patterns that are neither noticed nor avoided by the protagonist while driving, or while living his day-to-day life. These details again speak to the amazing craftsmanship of David Fincher and what magic can be done through an attention to screenplay and camera angles, a factor that is highlighted numerous times in the film. And it's probably one of the factors that make this film so iconic even after almost 20 years since its release. Every single move that has been taken by the protagonist, every single background and every single conversation is alluding to the final pieces of the puzzle that the protagonist is holding, and the key to the answers. Answers concerning not only his own life and destiny, but answers related to his father's suicide, and reality and the way he has been perceiving things in his life. In the second half of the film, we see our protagonist entering the office of the CRS. Here again, the amazing color play by David Fincher and the attention to detail makes the whole scene self-explanatory. The suit that is being worn in the scene by the protagonist blends perfectly with the background of the CRS, similar to an animal being able to blend in with his environment, indicating that there is an extreme sense of comfort in the protagonist, as the environment of the CRS is just any corporate building, i.e. the protagonist's natural habitat. Yet the CRS pushes him to his limits and again ironically highlights the fact that despite the protagonist thinking that he is the one in control of the whole narrative and the series of events, he is not, just like his life before the CRS. And the series of events do get out of his control, as he ends up in the middle of a graveyard in Mexico, trapped in a grave, but this time for once perhaps in his entire life he comes to the realization of how trapped he is and has been for the entirety of his life. This entrapment is the reality that he has lived for so long. The moment of amazement for both the audience and the protagonist comes after his attempted suicide. As he tries to take his own life, he ends up realizing that this was only a part of the game, and by attempting to take his own life the protagonist has freed himself from so many constraints and fears that he had of becoming like his father, fear of dying and fear of not being in control. Towards the very last scenes of the film we see the protagonist finally breaking down and expressing emotions, and letting go of the previous beliefs and practices that had made his life so mundane. The amazing twist of color play and the background music that has been used by David Fincher is the cherry on top. From the all-white that Nicholas wears in the Mexican grave ward that blends him perfectly with his environment, indicating that he is not special and not different from the rest of the people, dead people to be precise, in the graveyard, to the color play we see in the environment and the backgrounds. While the protagonist lives in a gloomy place, and his house is surrounded by shades of brown and black, the environment in the outside world is so full of colors. Colors that are absent in his life. This film is one of the very few that does not have a hero that comes in shining armor. Rather, it shows a real person dealing with problems and issues. He is just a human being, one that is capable of making mistakes, and despite his wealth and luxuries, he feels trapped. It portrays a reality which not a lot of people are aware of. The film also goes on to highlight that it is extremely lonely at the top.